بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful, to all of our viewers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back again to the intersection of faith and reason with our guest, Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Ja'far, again, it's a pleasure to be with you, and thank you for being with us today. Last time, we were talking about the rational evidence that the Quran gives to it being a revelation from the Creator. And I think we were leading into the fact that the way we know about our Creator is either through creation and or revelation. Mm-hmm. And we said something about the creation and what it tells us about God in the rational deduction of some of the attributes of God. But there are some attributes that can only be known as to what God says about himself. There is no room for rational deduction there. And I think that's what we will be talking about. What type of descriptions does the Quran give to
but
the Creator?
Even this has something to do with rationality. Hmm. Because one of the an evidence for the fact that the Quran is a revelation of God is the way that it describes him. Hmm. And it does not attribute to him any kind of imperfection, mm-hmm. like some religions do. And it does not make him something like an abstract, something as the philosophers do. Mm-hmm. He's a real being, he is living, he is merciful, and he is perfect. So the fact that you find a description of God that makes him the perfect being he should be is itself a proof that it is from God. This is God speaking about himself. It is not a philosopher speaking about God or someone imagining what God is. But even the Quran, when it says something on many occasions, when it says something about God, it tells us that this is how he should be. Yani, this is a matter you should have known by your own reason. For example, when some people said, God said about them, وَإِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً قَالُوا وَجَدْنَا عَلَيْهَا آبَاءَنَا وَاللَّهُ أَمَرَنَا بِهَا. When they do something indecent, they say, this is what we have found our forefathers doing, and this is what God ordered us to do. And then the Quran says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَأْمُرُ بِالْفَحْشَةِ. Mm-hmm. Allah does not command you to do something which is indecent. And this is something that you should have known. When those people said, مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِّن شَيْءٍ, Allah never sent any message to anyone. He said, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ, إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِّن شَيْءٍ. They have not given God his due. When this is something that you should have come to by your own reason, mm-hmm. that and so on. So argument, one evidence for the fact that the Quran is the word of God is this fact that it gives you a perfect description of the Creator. And also what it says about prophets, mm-hmm. about prophets. You know, I was told that you made a study of this, what some religions say about people like Noah or Abraham or Moses, and so they attribute to them things that even an ordinary criminal will not do. The Quran says this cannot be the case, because when you say this, you are attributing to God himself something that does not befit him. He chose these people, these are chosen people. He chose them to convey his message. So even a wise human being would choose the right will do his best to choose the right person for the right job.
Sure.
What about God? He would not say, send someone who sleeps with his daughter or who sent someone to die so that he may marry his wife and so on.
To be his spokesman or to deliver his message to the rest of
that,
humanity.
That can't be. Or to tell people that I am your Lord or I am the son of the Lord or so. God says this can't be the case. Allah chooses people whom he knows would convey the message in the best way, and not only would convey it not only with their words, but also with their deeds. They become models for religious people, models in their moral behavior, in their religious behavior. So the Quran also gives us a good picture, the picture that it should be of the prophets of God. None of them was divine. All were human, but they were the best human beings.
Just to go back to the part where God discusses himself in the Quran, I am just stricken by the number of times and the different ways that God speaks about himself. One of my favorite names of Allah, or one of my favorite attributes, is this idea of Allah is alim, the knower of everything that's out there. And I remember one time I was asked to give a speech in a church, and usually a person would do his own studies before the invited Muslim guest speaker come over in order to say the proper thing in front of the speaker, which is something that we really appreciate when we go there. So the person that was introducing me, he got himself a copy of the Quran and he started reading it to get himself familiarized with this new thing that is coming their way. And he said he was struck by how God speaks about himself in the Quran. He said God keeps repeating Wallahu ya'lamu, that Allah knows. And he said in his
introduction to you,
well he said that to me, but he said that in his own studies of his own scripture, he said that there was this idea of God sees but not necessarily aware. And he said he was just struck by how Allah insisted that Allah knows. And when you look into what Allah knows, when there are people, he knows what they conceal and what they reveal. He knows what comes down from the sky. He knows what erupts out of the earth. He knows that which happened in the past. He knows that which will happen in the future. So as you said, these are absolutely magnificent attributes of perfection that is...
And because he is all-knowing, and add to this that he is wise, he is merciful, and that is why whatever he tells must be the truth, and whatever he commands must be just. And this is mentioned in the Quran, وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. صِدْقًا. صِدْقًا means it is true. All the statements are true, and all the commands are just. So there is nothing unjust. Allah will never command people to do something which is unfair or unjust, and He will never tell them, conveys to them something that is not true. So these are some examples of the perfection of
And creation. And he said previously, you also said that the idea is not just to acknowledge him as a creator, but you must also get to know him. This idea of needing to know God or must know God. I really don't want to speak on behalf of other people, but rarely we all want to obey God. So our questions revolve around, what does God want from me? How does he want me to pray? How much does he want me to pay in my in my zakah? Rarely do we ask, who is this God that is asking me to do this?
I mean, your obedience to him must be raised, based on some, of course, knowledge. But knowledge of God, like knowledge of everything, increases. So every person who worships God, he worships him because he knows something about him that makes him worship him. So I don't think that they do this in complete ignorance of who they are worshiping.
Well, like you said, our commitment to God and wanting to worship him and obey him more would increase as a result of us knowing more about
and,
him.
And there is a reciprocal relationship between the two. The more you worship him, the more you know about him. God is not known just by reading his book or so, but also by worshiping him. When you worship him, you will have what they call a personal experience with him. And this is what Muslims call Iman al-Ajais, the faith of the old people. It is a real faith, but it is not a faith that is based on knowledge of scripture or so. It is based on personal experience with the Creator. So, إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. Those who fear God are the people who know, means the people who know Him. So, if someone doesn't fear Him, even if he, commits all the Quran to memory or learns by heart thousands of ahadiths, he will still be less of a learned person than someone who knows only a few verses of the Quran and a few ahadiths of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, but who is very sincere in his worshiping of the Creator. He knows more about him than the person who learns those words by heart.
Okay. Sheikh, when we come back, I would like to raise the question you alluded to in your paper again, and that is, must have a personal relationship with him, and how Islam insists that there should be no intermediary between you and God, and it must be a very personal relationship with him. And we will get this as soon as we come back from our break. So please do stay tuned, and we shall return soon, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back again to the intersection of faith and reason, where our guest is Dr. Jaafar Sheikh Idris. Dr. Jaafar, before we went on to our break, we said that Islam insists that you must have a personal relationship with God, a relationship that should not only impact your life positively, but also a relationship that does not expect any intermediary between you and your Creator. Can you please shed some light on this?
This is something that's very important. It is what you might call the essence of Tawheed, the essence of believing in that only God should be worshipped. Because if you believe that there is someone or something between you and your Creator, you are saying that you cannot. That the Creator either does not hear you or listen to you or accepts your prayer except through this intermediary. And that is a kind of, according to the Quran, that is shirk, polytheism, that is kind of polytheism. And this was the problem with the Arabs to whom the Prophet was first sent. They had no problem with believing in the existence of the Creator, no problem with worshipping him, if you ask. Their problem was that they worshipped idols or besides him, idols or human beings or angels or whatever. And they didn't worship them as being like God. They said, وَمَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفًا We worship them only because we want them to bring us nearer to the Creator. And unfortunately, this is what now millions of Muslims are doing. Millions of Muslims are doing. They don't, they behave with some of the sheikhs or the dead people whom they call saints. They treat them in a way that in Islam is called worshipping.
Mm.
But they wouldn't like to use the word worship.
Mm.
But in fact, it is worshipping. If you go to someone, especially if he is dead, and you ask him to grant you a child, or and you make what is called dua, prayer in English, to pray him to make it, or if you believe that he is nearer to God, and you don't know, because this is something that must be based on knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
We know that prophets are nearer to God because he said this about them. We know about certain people that they will go to paradise because the prophet said this about them. But about other people, we can't be sure.
Mm-hmm.
Because a person can be a hypocrite. He can, at the last moment, do something that takes him to hellfire. We don't know. So we can never be sure that anyone is nearer to God than other people, except the people about whom God told us.
Sheikh, if I heard you correctly, you are saying that seeking an intermediary between you and God, if I heard it correctly, you're almost assigning some sort of imperfection to God, saying that God would not hear me.
It is true. This is true. Because if you say, some people even say in trying to justify this belief in intermediaries, they say, if you want something, perhaps you cannot go to the president of the king directly.
You must go through other people.
To other people to bring you near to the king. And in fact, this itself is the reason why they are assigning some kind of imperfection to God, because the king or the president doesn't know about you. Mm-hmm. He needs someone to tell him about you. But your Creator knows about you more than anyone else, perhaps more than the person or the thing you appoint or you assign as intermediary between you and your Creator.
Interesting. Sheikh, one thing I find to be impressive as well is that the theology of Islam is very liberating, and in the sense that there is no concept of clergyman, there is no concept of sainthood, there is no concept of intermediary. I find that to be so unbelievably what we call freeing and liberating, in the sense that your relationship between you and God, nobody comes in between.
You see, in fact, the truth is that, and many people, of course, have said this, the more you are obedient to your Creator, the freer you are.
Interesting.
Now, some people think of freedom as being free even from worshipping God. Says, but in fact, no one can be absolutely free. Either you are a slave of your Creator, and this is the fact that should be, or you become a slave of something else.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot be absolutely free. Only the Creator is absolutely free. So people who imagine that they become freer by not obeying God or his prophet, in fact, they are being enslaved by some lesser gods. And the Quran says about many of this. For example, if someone follows a leader, he's somewhat obeying that leader. If someone follows أرأيت من اتخذ إلهه هواه. Someone follows his whims,
his own desires.
Yeah, this he becomes a slave of that. In fact, worshipping God, it liberates you from being a slave to your desires. Many people who think that they are free, in fact, they follow their desires. They are enslaved by their desires.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. I am reminded of a story of a Hindu man that once came to the mosque to observe prayers for the first time coming in. And I believe it was a silent prayer, meaning that a prayer that is not read out loud. And when he came, he was only able to pick up Allahu Akbar. That is the only thing that kept being repeated. So at the end of the prayers, he said, what does this word mean, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar? And it was explained to him that it means God is greater. And he said, He said, this is the best democracy I have seen in action, where we can actually come all together and declare no one is great but God.
Yes.
And I thought that was,
yes.
It was a very, sometimes we do it mechanically, but that it was very liberating to know this about our relationship with God and the fact that no one should.
Yes, I learned a lot from the experience of people who, who come to the fold of Islam. As you said, they realize things that we don't realize. We have become accustomed to. For example, Yusuf, my son, was telling me about a student girl. She was very young. And she said she was thinking about religion and so on, and she found a copy of the Quran. And she told him that when she started reading from Al-Baqarah, Al-Fatiha and Al-Baqarah.
These are the first and the second chapters of the Quran.
And when she read ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, this is a book wherein there is no doubt, she put it down and said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ, just to herself. You have read this 1,000 times. Why did she say this? Because she comes from a background, a religious background, where there is real doubt about the scripture. Now she is told that this is a book wherein there is no doubt. And someone else, I was told, he was a priest in Africa, and he was asked why he became a Muslim. He said, when I read the Quran, I said, this must be God speaking. The author of this book does not speak like a human being. He doesn't say, I think, or this might be so, or perhaps I am wrong.
No apologetic statement.
No, everything is mentioned in absolute, absolute sureness that this is so, this is so. So it is true that sometimes people who come to the who are new Muslims observe certain things, and they ask also certain questions. I remember the first time I went to the United States. That was in the 70s. Someone asked me, "Why are some of the prayers silent and some you read like Isha
out loud?"
I never asked myself that question. And I thought of an answer, but I told him that this was my own thinking, and I'm not depending on any verse or hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I think also, since you are enumerating the different kinds of evidence that show that the Quran is a revelation from God, the Quran says that this is a book that guides you. This is a book that guides you. So the evidence for the fact that it's a revelation from God is its effect on people who believe in it. And this can be from the, a person can speak about his personal experience, but also other people can see the change
in
that it made, it makes on the people who follow it.
You hear this, I'm sorry, Sheikh, but you would hear this A lot was people talking about medicine, for example.
Yeah.
This medicine must be good because, look, it has done this to me, it has done this. And even that is how many times medicine is advertised to people out there.
Yeah.
Sheikh, believe it or not, we did come to the end of this part of our program, of this particular episode. But inshallah, we will be back next time. We shall return. And with this, we say to you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, and so long.